Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Second Chance by Vasily Mahanenko. Translated by Colin Parker. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Chapter 1. They haven't taken over everything. Another round? As if to disprove me, an imitator waiter appeared. Its subservient physiognomy irritated. But we couldn't refuse the offer. Otherwise, we would have to leave the establishment. The owners kept a strict eye on guests, so they wouldn't be distracted from spending money. I remind you that you can receive a discount by stating your Barliona login. The size of the discount depends on your character's level. Oh, wake up, bro. These monsters are everywhere, hissed Maddie angrily, unembarrassed in front of the robot. You know who doesn't have them? The army. Because it's more interesting to fight with live soldiers. You can be a real hero, even a spy. Intrigue all around. Why the hell not? An RPG in reality, with a cargo 200 bonus, and they're way creative. All of them. What are you getting so wound up about? I thought everything was hunky-dory with you. His overexcitement was getting to me. Surely it was me who had problems. And here he was getting all emotional. Hunky-dory? What would you know? 5 years ago, everything was fine. Then, it all went wrong. All of a sudden, Maddie wilted and looked glum. He drained his glass of vodka. The repair shop closed 3 years ago. Almost all the customers went over to the imitators. They're fast, reliable, and free. That's a car manufacturer's lifetime guarantee for you. What could we offer to counter that? Exactly nothing. Although we took the piss as best we could. We put a huge display stand of family photos by the entrance. Children, wives, parents, dogs. Get it? Pictures from a family album all about happiness, so that when the client picked up his pride and joy, he understood he was feeding someone and would have to come back. Shocked by the news, I swallowed the lump in my throat. Why didn't you call me? What for? To say, hi, mate. How's it going up there on Mount Olympus? Still building Hell's Kitchen for us? You were building shelters, weren't you? I was, I said. Up until then, it had just been installing and setting servers for the social shelters, a government contract. Yet another project with no reference to specific people or goals. We were silent, each thinking our own thoughts. Liz left. No money coming in, children to feed. Josh Spenning had a thing for her ever since school. Maybe you remember him. He's doing well for himself now. Moved to a rich part of town. Suggested she moved in too. He'd keep her. The kids are with her, and now they've got loads of toys, clubs, sport. I see them once a week. That's how hunky-dory it is. Maddie spoke reluctantly and softly, as though afraid of what he was saying. I felt even more wretched now, thinking I could have found out for myself if only I'd been interested in his life. I could have been there to support him. Maddie's family was everything to him. I'm such an asshole. I never called you once to ask how you were. You didn't call either, and no news is good news. Forget it. I'm not pissed off with Liz. What do I have to offer her apart from a shelter? By the way, they're not bad little mansions. Well played, he chuckled. Don't start. I'm sick of it myself. I'd asked for it, envisaging a pod in a concrete anthill as a home for my best buddy. If I can't find a job, I'll move close to you. We can be neighbors. Bro, you know me. I didn't drag you here out of self-pity, said Maddie, shaking off his melancholy. I've got a proposal for you. How are you with Barliona? Not good. I started a couple of times and gave up. I can't be sitting in a pod with my job. It's not my thing anyway. Are you trying to entice me into your game? And introduce a friend and receive a bonus promotion stunt? Something like that. He wasn't offended. Listen, I've been in the game 3 years, and I haven't done half bad for a vagrant. I've got money, connections. But I'm not blind. I see the clan officers taking most of the loot and leaving us with next to nothing. There are hordes of vagrants in Barliona now, so the clans don't cling on to us so desperately. If they're dissatisfied with something, they're told to get lost. A paid account, on the other hand, is something else. This is what I've thought up. It's not easy to earn money in Barliona, but it is possible. First, you need your own clan. While you've got money, you can subscribe, create a character, organize your own business. Remember school? I do the handiwork, you do the brain work. How long did you spend just learning to manage things, bro? Plus, with a paid account, you'll have kudos and bonuses all over the place. Reference information. Account types. Social one size fits all. A pay-as-you-go account for people living in social housing and prisons, with a compulsory contribution to the government of 30% of all income. In the game, players with this type of account have their name underlined in red, which cannot be hidden. Commercial account, beginner. An account with a monthly fee of 11 credits, without bonuses. Most popular with school children and students. Commercial account, basic. An account with a monthly fee of 525 credits. Bonuses, experience plus one. Reputation plus two. Commercial account, premium. An account with a monthly fee of 2,100 credits. Bonuses. Experience, plus 3. Reputation, plus 5. Favorable terms and offers from the game bank. Opportunity to become a member of the top private game clubs. You're suggesting I waste my time and money in Barliona just to end up in a shelter even sooner? Instead of looking for a job and swapping my commercial account for a vagrant one? Yeah, right! The skeptic in me was fuming. If only it was all that simple, Maddie, then half of us would be Mayans. Dream on. Who knows? Maybe it is a dream. But you have to believe in something. And I believe you'd make a damn good clan chief. We can find earners, buy a castle. I'll do the creative stuff. We'll earn a ton of cash, and everything will turn out all right. He was interrupted by an electronic signal from the device on his wrist. The imitator came over. Matthew Lavery, your reality time limit expires in 30 minutes. A taxi is waiting for you by the entrance. Payment will be debited from your account. Maddie rolled up his sleeve and shook his metal bracelet. Everyone on a social contract had one, to monitor their whereabouts, time management skills, health, and other important stats. Damn convenient piece of kit, he winked. If you change your mind, give me a buzz, and good luck in the job search. He rose from the table, thought for a moment, and necked another shot. The pod will flush me out anyway, and the way home will be more chilled, he explained before waving goodbye. Lead on, O soulless one. The imitator saw Maddie out and returned. Another drink? Or would you like to move to the VIP lounge? The machine could see my account balance and was doing its utmost to reduce it. The VIP lounge entailed live serving personnel and doubled prices. Otherwise, it was no different from the general bar. No, I'm good, thanks. Debit payment from my account. Your companion has already paid the bill, said the imitator before escorting me to the door. Would you like to use the sober driver service? I declined, informing the robot I had autopilot, and climbed into my expensive car. Apart from a huge headache and no free time, my job as project manager had also provided me with a decent income. The car drove past blocks being readied for demolition. The alcohol and the conversation with Maddie evoked thoughts of social inequality. High-rises were being knocked down and mansions built in their place. Mansions like mine, large, comfortable, and expensive. I'd never given thought to where the people would go. An entire district, hundreds of 20-story buildings, 1,000 flats in each, and each flat housing a family. Surely they can't all be in Barliona. Now was probably not the best time to think about it. The following morning was fine and sunny, unlike my physical and mental state. I hadn't been that drunk for ages. My head pounded mercilessly, and my body begged to be horizontal again. It was only the nauseating, electronic, incoming correspondence signal that prevented me from dying in peace. The sound came from the smart home management module and indicated receipt of a letter from the management company. Taking a couple of shaky steps, I accepted I wouldn't be able to cope without the robo-doctor and trudged through to the kitchen to deal with my hangover. Dear Mr. West, the management company, Everything for a Present Future, would like to remind you that your prepaid one-year lease on mansion in Sector 2, address House 43, Street 2, terminates 4 months from today. Your current account balance is sufficient to extend the lease for 2 years, including advanced payment of utility charges. Considering the absence of weekly deposits into your account, the management company would be happy to offer you a comfortable flat in Sector 5 at a price to suit you. You can browse all the options by following the link below. The price of a one-year lease includes a two-room flat with standard conveniences, direct connection to Barliona, and secure parking. The management company has studied your levels of social and intellectual development and has selected the most suitable neighbors for you. To extend your lease or apply for a housing swap, look in the My Profile section of the main menu. We are pleased to be of service to our clients and to make their future a comfortable present.
Fuck off with your joyful concern. I've only been unemployed for a week.
Sector 5 was a high-rise ghetto on the outskirts of the city, a concentration of human desperation, crime, and all manner of disease. Even the police didn't bother showing their faces around there. Why would they? Let the dregs destroy themselves. Fewer people equals fewer problems. There was only one way out of there, into a long-stay pod. And I wasn't ready to give up my place in the sun, in the literal sense of that expression. Submitting to a momentary fit of rage, I flipped the finger at the entirely blameless management module and extended the lease on my comfortable and expensive domicile for another year. I spent the whole day checking my email, sending my resume to some of the bigger companies, and phoning work contacts. Nothing. Out of 20 companies, only 7 responded, all of them with rejections. Project managers had been replaced with the new generation of imitators. Looking at the employment sites was fairly damn joyless, too. Every job offer had loads of replies, whether it was for a VIP establishment waiter or a specialist in microelectronics. White-collar workers were no use to anybody. Reading forums, phoning acquaintances, and lunch with a particular big cheese proved no cause for celebration, either. By the end of the day, I was seriously ready to contemplate Maddie's proposal. People on the forums agreed about one thing. Barliona was now pretty much the only place where you could earn anything at all. So for want of anything better to do, I decided to do some homework on the subject, filtering out the adverts. A rigorous analysis of the information available took me 2 hours, and my conclusion indicated that Maddie's suggestion was not an option. The game was created for people to spend money, not to earn it. What the vagrants called earnings was peanuts compared to my usual take-home, and even then they hoarded it,
scrimping on everything, and paranoid about anyone taking anything. The comfort and security of your personal assets came at a price. Absolutely everything cost money, from the use of the bank to a scroll of flight to expanding your inventory. All this convinced me Barliona was designed to relieve players of their money, time, and reason, and in no way to provide them comfort in their declining years. An incoming correspondence notification flashed up. On autopilot, I opened my mailbox. With all the stress and fatigue, my brain had switched off.
"Greetings, Mr. West. We have perused your resume and would like to invite you to an interview at our company for the position of project manager. The interview will take place..."
"Yes!" I shouted, without even reading the details. My body was gasping for any opportunity to make up its deficit in feel-good hormones. For the first time ever, I regretted not having someone close to share this small piece of non-binding good news with. The company inviting me to interview was not a giant in some market or other. In fact, I could only find a couple of mentions in the internet. No scandals, quantum leaps, or participation in tenders. And oddly, everything I could glean about my potential employer came from their own website. A supplier of network equipment, with its own consulting and commissioning departments. Just what I was looking for. In years of managing projects, I had studied all this stuff in such detail I could work as a manager, architect, or design engineer. If they'd let me prove myself, that was. My reply was quick and concise. "Your offer is interesting. I am familiar with the company. I will definitely be there." Almost immediately, I received confirmation that my letter had been read, and a few seconds later, a contact request appeared in the messenger application of my mail client. HRS@rightdecision.com requests to be added to your list of contacts. WTF? There's a real live employee sitting there? The system clock read 1 o'clock a.m. I clicked on Accept Message.
"HR Department. Good evening, Mr. West. Please forgive me for disturbing you at such a late hour. I saw your letter and decided to reply."
Brody West. "Good evening. No problem. I'm not sleeping anyway."
"We arranged for your interview for tomorrow at midday, but unfortunately, the head of the department is flying out at 10 a.m. You can wait for her return, or come to the interview at 8 a.m. tomorrow."
"Tomorrow at 8 a.m. Thank you for warning me."
"Pleased to be of assistance. We will expect you tomorrow at 7:50. I will order a pass for you."
What the F? A smiley from a real live HR employee. And a live interview. Could it be a joke? Job interviews went virtual eons ago. My last live interview was about 10 years ago. Nothing but a waste of precious time. Maybe this was just a test to see how much I valued my time and theirs.
"You mean I have to come to the office? Why not use conference call? Especially since the head of department is flying out."
"There's nothing to be afraid of. Live interaction at work is a company policy. Our staff consists only of people."
"Why?"
"That's not for me to say. Come and see us and you'll find out everything. Good night."
"Good night." I was intrigued, to say the least.
Good night?
I googled Right Decision Limited with renewed vigor, but learned nothing new. Old links concerning charity affairs and their website. That was it. There was no information whatsoever in the internet about companies which had opted out of imitator services. Some random company with a load of inconsistencies. How could you provide network equipment for imitators without even using imitators? HRS@rightdecision.com was still online. The silence of the empty house was stifling, and I wanted to continue our chat, the more so because my curiosity was getting the better of me. "Can I ask you a question? As long as it's just one, and it's not about work. Why did you write to me here? You could have called tomorrow, or advised me in a letter. I saw the message read notification, and figured you really needed a job." "So you took pity on me?" "That was your second question. See you tomorrow." So much for the chat. A cup of chamomile tea was more comforting than the abortive chinwag, and I went to bed. The interview with the head of the project management office was a walk in the park. I was tested on my knowledge of my professional sphere, asked to elaborate on details of successfully completed projects, and, as is usual, to comment on problematical situations before being informed that on the whole I fitted their requirements. The working conditions suited me, as did the salary. The office manager waved away my questions about the project, saying I would find out everything if I got past the big boss, and after wishing me success, he headed off to an exhibition of new imitator prototypes on a different continent. If only I lived like that. A girl entered the conference hall and said, "Good morning. Could you please fill in these forms, and I'll take you through to Mr. Williams's reception room." I silently took the papers from the outstretched hand of the clearly recent school leaver. She sat down opposite me, trying to look important, but her hastily gathered hair and ink-stained hands ruined her businesswoman image. Paper forms? A ballpoint pen? Yet another anachronism to add to the list of the company's quirks. I hadn't held real documents in my hands for years. I'd even forgotten what a pleasant sensation quality paper could produce. "My name is Helen. I'm your personal HR manager. If you have any questions, please ask." "Hello, Helen. Was it you I spoke to today?" "Today?" The girl frowned and wiped her forehead with dirty fingers, smearing ink on it. "No, yesterday. Yes, I mean today." So this was who I had to thank for the successfully rescheduled interview. This young, homely creature, on her first day at work. It explained a lot, especially the smileys. At that age, feelings of compassion haven't yet atrophied, and the desire to show one's worth runs high. Not to worry, we've all been there. It passes with time. It was a good job our chat hadn't got off the ground, otherwise I would have been feeling very embarrassed just then. "Helen, thank you for organizing the interview. You're a very responsible employee." I flashed the girl a friendly smile to thank her for her consideration. "Your diligence is literally written across your forehead." I demonstratively wiped my own forehead, unsure how to drop the hint without offending her sensibilities. At first, she just frowned and mirrored my gesture. Then the penny dropped, and she squealed. "I've smudged my forehead again, haven't I? I just can't get used to this thing actually writing. Styluses aren't messy like that." I smiled politely again and busied myself with filling in the standard HR forms, while Helen cleaned herself up with a tissue. 20 minutes later, the sweet, though very young, HR girl led me to reception and handed me over to a real office shark. It was etched into everything, from her stylish coiffure to the tips of her high heels. The high-class secretary was arranging documents, and with such dignity and focus that doomsday itself paled before the importance of the task. All I merited was a curt glance from her severe and impeccably mascaraed eyes, motioning me toward a visitor's chair. Not a single word. But who needs words anyway? Words would only have spoiled the whole magic of that silent yet evocative film. It was entertaining to see a real live secretary in action. Due to the efforts of directors' wives, secretaries had been among the first to be replaced by imitators, relieving honest women of that particular headache.
Were I conscious of my own uniqueness, I might well behave that way too. The internal telephone on the table rang.
Yes, Nathan, of course,
said the secretary in an incongruously pleasant voice. She replaced the receiver, and looking at me coldly, nodded toward the office door.
You may go in.
A semi-darkness reigned in the room, diluted by the light of a projector. On a small screen, I saw the first slide of my resume. Nathan Williams was sitting at his desk and unhurriedly poring over the contents. He cut an interesting figure. Expensive suit and tie, manicure, watchful stare, and no sign of plastic surgery to conceal his age. I had read on the company website that the owner of Right Decision Limited was over 90, and for that age, he looked amazing. In the comments, it mentioned that he did not use a medical pod on principle, having on the staff a human doctor who was just as ancient as him. Looking at his wrinkled face, that was easy to believe. His liver spots didn't add to William's charm, but in no way did they affect his working capacity. His mind remained ever alert and inquiring.
"Take a seat,"
said Nathan with some effort. His hoarse, 40-cigarettes-a-day voice was more suited to a ship's captain than a businessman. The slides changed on the screen. A photo. Achievements from my previous places of work. Personal information. I didn't recognize the last slide, which contained information from the security service. There couldn't be anything to be ashamed of. A career in a prestigious company obliged you to take good care of your personal and business reputation. Reaching the end of the presentation, the owner asked,
"Brody, what is your relationship with God?"
Only now did I notice the Bible on his desk and a large crucifix on the wall. Both objects looked very expensive, and several bookmarks made of torn pieces of paper protruded from the book. I don't know what my face reflected, but long-forgotten obscenities swam up in my head. Fuck! You have to warn people in advance about corporate policies like that. I wasn't an atheist, but I preferred not to have anything to do with God. At all. You could call me an agnostic. I believed there was something somewhere, but it didn't encroach in our lives and did not demand worship. With regard to faith, that was enough for me. But what do you say when your only source of income is at stake? I searched desperately for a correct response. I am christened. That was my parents' decision. But I don't go to church.
You misunderstand me. I wasn't asking about your relationship to the institution of faith. I was asking about your relationship with God.
That's a very personal question, Mr. Williams. I need a job, and I don't know how to answer your question in order to get it. The old man laughed.
Brody, there are no correct answers here. I'm just interested to know what sort of person wants to work in my company.
I think I would best describe myself as an agnostic.
Thank you for your honesty. People are losing their faith. It's tragic, but not without reason. Barliona can also be used to control the people, can't it?
I didn't know what to say and shrugged my shoulders. I wanted this to end soon and with some degree of certainty. It was crappy practice to philosophize on the subject of citizen control techniques during a job interview.
Tell me, Brody, what is good about faith? Why do people believe in God?
Because it's easier to overcome hardship. Some people don't have enough strength of their own, and faith supports them, humbles them. It's like an element of psychotherapy.
Good. I like your answer. You've probably noticed certain peculiarities of the company. I shall explain. It's connected with my faith, and that, as you correctly stated, is very personal. Consider everything which doesn't fit into a normal framework for you to be the folly of a pious old man. When all is said and done, what does it matter if I give you the opportunity to pay for a villa in Sector 2, and at the same time, don't demand that you share my feelings, right? He laughed again. With a couple of unconventional questions, he had checked my resolve in a stressful situation and defined the limits of what was admissible. Whatever underpinned his methods of business organization, he acknowledged the right of his employees to choose their own faith, but demanded the same of them. It does no harm in this business to remember who pays who and for what.
And now to business. Tell me about yourself.
I breathed a sigh of relief when I heard this more familiar interview phrase, in view of the fact that my life story had recently flickered across the screen. The request was obviously loaded. A classic test of attention to detail. Without touching on information already provided, I had to flesh out my resume. Which was all well and good, but the facts needed sifting through scrutinously. Otherwise, the security service would not have done its job properly. Knowledge of such details allowed relations with the security team not to be spoiled from the word go. I had a set piece ready for just this situation. Brody West, 35 years of age, divorced. Employment history as project manager, over 13 years. 3 major and 25 smaller projects successfully completed. I prefer to use Gantt charts and PMI methodology, considering other methodologies superfluous or inadequate. As tools for Gantt charts, I use...
Enough.
Nathan cut me off, twiddling his fingers nervily. A company owner is the last person who wants to hear the jabberings of a potential mid-level manager, which was exactly what I was banking on.
Have you been told about the project?
No, but I'm ready to take on anything lawful. My experience enables me to manage any size of project concerning the construction of network infrastructure. That's why I'm here. Williams was quiet for a while, concentrating on the restarted presentation. After rubbing his red eyes, he pressed a button on the desk with a shaking hand and said,
"You've got the job, but there are conditions. Go and have everything explained."
The secretary came in and stood by the door, holding it open. I said goodbye to Williams and left. The lady followed me out, sat down at her desk and, in a businesslike manner, held out a file of documents, saying, "Brody, here is the decision of the personnel department concerning your candidacy. The director has already approved it." The file contained my slides printed out on copy paper. When I got to the conclusions page, I was flabbergasted. Avoids solid social relationships outside the workplace? Seriously? The conclusions of the local psychologists stated categorically that I had problems communicating with other people outside work. When was I supposed to socialize and establish these solid relationships if I was at work from 8 in the morning till 10 in the evening? I stared at the secretary, demanding an explanation of what this had to do with the company. She took the file back and flicked through it. "The conclusions are based on an analysis of the last 4 years of your life," she began. "You have no family, friends, or interests. Even in Barliona, you're represented by a level 10 character. Your entire life is work. You are in a risk group."
"What risk group?" I asked, gobsmacked, still not quite grasping what they were trying to tell me, and unable to get my head round the surreal situation.
The secretary slapped the file shut. "The company is not interested in hiring employees with a risk of developing depression or neurosis from loneliness. If you notice, we pay particular attention to interaction."
especially real-world interaction. Even our electronic document flow is kept to a minimum. Brody, has anyone ever made you work 13 hours a day?
No, but work must be completed on time.
Apparently, the lady and I lived in different realities. In mine, any boss was happy if a person lived at work and for work.
So you're a good project manager, but managing your working time is beyond you, right? Or were you just afraid to leave the office before the management?
She raised a mocking eyebrow. A secretary able to play with facts. I must tell the girls to register you for the time management course. Don't worry. It's a common problem now. The director considers it necessary to remind employees about the importance of free time, socializing, and other pleasures.
So, to work for you, I have to get married? Or will sexual relations with a long-standing partner suffice? Angry that strangers were teaching me how to live, I couldn't resist a touch of sarcasm.
If sex is supplied to you on a contractual basis, it doesn't count, replied the secretary, utterly unabashed. Brody, do you need a job?
I nodded gloomily, and she smiled at me almost humanly.
Then let's dispense with these attempts to rub me up the wrong way. We are currently recruiting a team. The project begins in 10 months' time. Your professional qualities are impressive. Your personal ones are cause for alarm. The latter is a priority for our company, but the former permits us to give you a chance. Attend our training course. Of course, it's not exactly what you need, but you have to start somewhere.
And how will you know when I no longer cause alarm for your psychologists and HR people?
That's no problem for them. While you're on the course, they'll watch you and suggest an individual approach to solving the problem.
For example,
I already didn't know what to expect from these people.
Anything at all. You can make it up for yourself. Meet up with friends, take interest in their lives, have lunch with your parents more often. If you find a steady partner, it can only be a good thing. Or join a clan in Barliona. You can socialize there. The main thing is that it should be just for fun, and not for the pursuit of some work-related goal. Understand?
I understand, I replied unenthusiastically.
It irked me that people had weighed me up and were now giving me their recipes for normalcy.
It's important for us to evaluate your ability to communicate with people outside work. During this time, Nathan is willing to employ you officially as an intern, with a salary of 25% of a project manager's full pay. If you accept, sign the last page. There's a pen on the stand.
Biometrics had long since replaced personal documents in our state, and a handwritten signature had lost all meaning. Your fingerprints and the retinas of your eyes were always with you, and when you held them to the scanner, you weren't worried about forgeries. Tired of the weirdness and excessive questions, I just wrote my surname. I didn't have a specific flourish for these situations, because these situations didn't arise. I would deal with everything as it happened, since there was no other way out. I needed any work I could get, because I wanted my own house, a real piece of meat, and the real sun.
Welcome to the company, Brody. Training begins in 1 hour. Helen will show you the way. The secretary folded my signed papers meticulously and filed them away.
Okay. I hesitated, realizing I didn't know her name.
How should I address you?
Victoria.
Victoria. I still haven't been told anything about the project, I said, reminding her of the purpose of my visit.
All information upon completion of your training. Helen, show Brody to the training hall. The course turned out to be standard communication training, the likes of which I'd seen a gazillion times before. Never mind seen, I used to run them myself. For a good half hour, myself and 7 other unfortunates were subjected to tired tropes explaining the importance of communication and live contact with co-workers. Badly, and by the wrong person. Little Helen, standing by the board, studiously drew adaptation graphs, recited wise quotes, and even read a short piece on the history of the imitators, without understanding the first thing about it herself. It was clear she had mastered the methodology well enough, but she'd never actually been to an event like this. The result was a master class in how not to conduct a training session. With my experience and the necessary knowledge, out of sympathy for the girl, I gently seized the initiative and organized a Brownian motion business scenario. One of the best ways to acquaint people with each other is to take the heat off by showing the need for nonverbal communication. It was curious to watch people who were used to exclusively digital interaction blushing and becoming flustered in their attempts to think up new ways to greet another person. At first, tactily and silently, then tactily and verbally, and by the end, just verbally. After touching another person twice, they now found it difficult to readjust and greet them with only words. Following this, I introduced a standard scenario called Find 5 Positive Features of Your Neighbor, which forced them to enter into dialogue, communicate, and draw conclusions about somebody based on that communication. Helen forgot completely about her role and became actively involved in the game. And by the end of the session, the atmosphere was certainly warm, if not friendly. Eventually came the moment I'd been dreaming of since the very start. They let us go home. On the way out of the hall, I was intercepted by a stern-looking woman who turned out to be the head of HR and Helen's direct boss. "Brody, I'd like a word with you." I went back into the hall to see Helen, now wearing headphones, tidying up and shaking her tousled head in time with the music. Seeing her superior in the doorway, she quickly removed the device and tried to adopt a serious look. It was comical, just like in school, I swear. "Brody, these sessions are not suitable for you," announced the lady. "You've clearly had experience of something similar before. When was that?"
"Way back at the dawn of my rebellious youth. And since then, I've often conducted them myself."
"You can tell. You helped me a lot," Helen chipped in.
"Helped?" the boss teased her. "He did your job for you. Should I give him your wages? It's shameful."
The dressing down had been friendly enough, but the girl's eyes sparkled with tears. The lady and I pretended we didn't see anything. To encourage sniveling in the workplace was the height of unprofessionalism. We were agreed on that.
"The training is pointless for you,"
the lady steered our conversation back on course.
"You were clearly in your element. You need taking out of your comfort zone, and we have a number of solutions. Please take a look at these."
An image flickered on the screen. At last, a glimpse of automation, a hint that this might yet be an IT company. A company trip to an exhibition of modern art, a fishing competition, a blind date, a character upgrade in Barliona.
"Stop, rewind. I agree to the training."
And I'd thought we were done with idiocy for the day.
"Brody, concentrate on the matter at hand, which is to take you out of your comfort zone."
She was relentless.
"I have another suggestion. You and I are business people, right?"
I wasn't about to give up so easily, so I said, "You still have to do the adaptation course for the others. I can help Helen, teach her. For that, we can keep an upgrade in Barliona, and we can forget about my personal life." She wasn't exactly fired up at the suggestion, and she fixed me with a heavy stare. But I didn't yield. Assistance came in a very unexpected form. Helen.
"Oh, Grandma, say yes. Brody can help me with my training, and I'll help him with his upgrade. I'll introduce him to my friends."
The boss's stern manner disappeared in an instant, and she said to her granddaughter,
"Helen, there is no grandma here. How many times do I have to tell you? Here I am, Maria."
said Maria, before turning back to me. "Very well, Barliona it is. It's good enough for your purposes. I see your case isn't too far advanced. With your acumen, Brody, you need to build your career using social connections."
"And I will," I chuckled, looking poignantly first at Maria and then Helen.
"So what's happening with Barliona? We have a checklist for that kind of adaptation, too." The projector displayed a list of 10 items. "On top of that, you will lead the course and teach Helen for 6 months, and then I will approve your socialization."
The HR manager had pronounced my sentence. "I'll be playing at home," I warned.
"You can play in the netherworld for all I care. God forgive me," she replied. I was beginning to take a shine to the lady. "But you will spend 2 hours every day in the office. I shall be checking up on you personally. Now off you go. I will be expecting you tomorrow."
I went home via the nearest Barliona office. I urgently needed a new pod with the standard frills, and the only game connection devices at home were a dusty old helmet and gloves, the kind long since discarded by everyone. Barliona had almost as many outlets as KFC or McDonald's. Each office had its own unique fantasy design based around a real object in the game. A medieval castle, an earth goblin burrow, or a witch's hut. The person who dreamt all this up was a genius. It was both advertising and immersion in the game, and you couldn't miss it. The office I came across was stylized as a country tavern. Everything was so real I could hear the creaking of worn steps under my feet, and the sweet aroma of food played with my empty stomach. The interior furnishings and decor also seemed authentically medieval. As you would expect, keeping house behind the oaken bar was an imitator innkeeper, and several customers, devil-may-care pirates or highwaymen, were drinking beer, playing dice, and poking fun at the serving girl. The most active and noisy were the imitators. The rest of the crowd consisted of holograms. There wasn't a single person among the office staff.
"Good day to you, Lord. What is your desire? I see this is your first time with us."
An electronic menu appeared on the counter. "A new client is a favorite client. In order to become our client, select a type of pod. General Continuous Immersion Pod, or GCI. Supplied free of charge. All standard features. Medical unit, sanitation unit, bed sore prevention and massager, pleasure pain impulse sensors, feeding tube. Professional Continuous Immersion Pod, or PCI. Supplied for an additional fee. All standard features, plus extras. Full tactile sensation unit. Olfactory center. Fitness module. Allowing increase of real physical characteristics, such as agility, strength, and endurance, whilst playing. Professional Transitory Immersion Pod, or PTI, supplied for an additional fee. All the extras of the PCI pod, but without some standard features. Medical unit, sanitation unit, bed sore prevention, feeding tube. Continuous game connection limit, maximum 3 hours. Interval between connections, minimum 1 hour. Familiarize yourself with the terms of the contract and the user agreement.
A multi-page text appeared, of the kind which, due to the nature of my profession, I was used to reading in full and with care. Cutting corners wasn't an option anyway, because the system monitored my eye movements and turned the page accordingly. It was impossible to just scroll to the end of the documents and touch a finger to the scanner to confirm my agreement with the contents. I didn't learn anything new, just the customary buck-passing from the administration to the player. I'd prepared identical documents myself and knew all the nuances. There could be no fault-finding. If I died or went bust, it would be my own fault. The system confirmed that my eyes had followed the text from start to finish and opened a new window. Touch any finger to the scanner screen.
Congratulations. You are a new, and therefore favorite, client. Select a type of pod and take the test
to define the limit of your tactile sensation. GCI, PCI, PTI. Test. Choosing a pod wasn't all that straightforward. The GCI was free, meaning I would save some money, but it was damn unpleasant when you could feel the feeding catheters, the urine collection bag, and whatever else inside your body. My body mass, now in three figures, had long been hinting at exercise. The household robo-doctor was forever complaining about my blood pressure and sugar and cholesterol levels, and suggesting a diet and exercise plan. But I would refuse, citing a mad rush at work, a bad mood, the release of the new Star Wars film, or just that it wasn't Monday. Ultimately, the choice was between the long-stay and short-stay professional models, and the advantages of the long-stay were obvious. I would fulfill the socialization tasks quicker, the inbuilt med unit would make sure I was losing weight, and significantly, in 6 months' time, I would be able to give the pod to Maddie. I'd be doing him a good turn. And I still felt guilty. Some things are worth loosening the purse strings for. No sooner had I signed the contract than a crew of service engineers left for my house to install the pod, without even waiting for it to be fully tested. The pods gave the user a whole range of tactile sensations to make the playing process as realistic as possible. But each one had its own sensitivity threshold, and so that the user didn't accidentally go schizo from overdosing on pleasure or pain, they ran checks before fixing the settings. My figures settled at roughly 30% pain and 80% pleasure. With high parameter readings, the conscious became addled or switched off altogether. In this respect, I was statistically average. It would be easier to fuck me to death than beat me to death.
Would you like to open an internal game bank account? If you do this the same day you sign the contract, we will offer you a discount.
As befitted any good worker, the imitator was trying to flog me optional extras. I had read up on the bank and the internal game accounts the previous evening, so I knew it was the same bells and whistles as the immersion pod. When a character regenerated, half the money they had at the moment of death remained at the place of death as loot. Beginners, of course, had nothing to lose, but as your level rose, so did your income, and thoughts of losing it would begin to torture everyone who was progressing. The bank offered an automatic transfer of money to your game account, bypassing any pockets. No cash meant you couldn't lose it. Only vagrants refused because, for them, losing half their money was no scarier than the commission for opening and maintaining a virtual account. What terms are you offering?
53 credits to open the account. A yearly service subscription of 58 credits. The commission for account transactions is 2% of the sum of the transaction.
I hope that's without the discount. I understood vagrants very well.
The discount applies only to opening an account. Without it, the fee is 70 credits. You can also merge a real account with a game account.
No, I'll keep the game account separate.
We have a promotion at the moment. If you top up your account with between 1,000 and 10,000 credits, you will receive an additional 20% from Barliona. And there is one small condition. You cannot withdraw the money for 3 months.
What a surprise. The last free gift I received was from Santa Claus, and that was brought by my dad. My account balance was no secret to the imitators, and they were trying their hardest to con me into converting real money into game money, in strict accordance with their raison d'etre. The less money a client had in reality, the less desire they had to return to that reality.
Transfer 15,000 credits to my game account.
Even so, the offer was very tempting.
Would you like access to a mailbox?
That will be all, thank you. I brought the conversation to a close. Being blessed with a brain, I would decide everything else after reading some forums and guides, and after a chat with my personal expert, Maddie.
When I got home, I was cheered by the news that the installation and setting of the pod would drag on into the late evening. I called Maddie.
Hey, buddy, can you talk?
Hey, bro. I always have time for you. Just wait a second and I'll log out.
If anyone was going to diss modern technology, it certainly wasn't me. You could call somebody even if they were in their pod. The main thing was to know their number.
Has something happened?
No, I just wanted some advice. I'm having a pod installed. Can you tell me about how to go about starting? I killed off my old guy.
So you decided to go for it? He said, thrilled.
I didn't want to go into details over the phone, so I responded with silence. But Maddie wasn't expecting anything else.
Cool! You've made my day.
Uh-huh. Listen, you said you worked it all out. Let's meet and you can tell me who to play and where to begin.
Great!
He was genuinely excited.
But only in 2 hours, okay? I've got to finish a quest against the clock. Some guys are waiting for me. Then we'll discuss everything.
Shit, bro, we've got big work to do. We're going to kick Barliona's ass for sure.
Maddie hung up, and I dialed the next number. I had a training session to prepare for.
Peter. Hi, it's Brody West. All good, thanks. Oh, you know already?
I've nearly found one, that's why I'm calling. How are you?
Great. Listen, remember we ran that communication course years ago? Have you still got the teacher training and preparation plan? It should be on the server in the archive somewhere.
Yeah, with the course.
I fancy giving it a go.
Yes, I know it's all out of date.
Can you send it in an email?
Thanks. I owe you.
Before meeting Maddie, I had just enough time to fry myself an enormous marbled steak. While I had money, no one was going to stop me enjoying a slap-up meal.
We arranged to meet in the park zone, just outside the city. Anywhere else would be difficult for him to get to. The social shelters were being built a 90-minute journey from the edge of the city, and the reasons were compelling enough. Firstly, to minimize time spent by social citizens among the free. The less a vagrant saw of normal, comfortable life, the fewer improper thoughts they would have. And if such thoughts did arise, then their realization would not be far off, an hour tops. Secondly, so that endless concrete anthills wouldn't ruin the green splendor the city had become. The park zones were being developed directly outside the city, specifically so the vagrants would have somewhere to stretch their legs. Beyond them was an exclusion zone, which only public transport was permitted to enter. The state, very charitably, paid to deliver the wearers of metal bracelets from their shelters to the park zone and back. To get you to the city, you had to take a taxi and pay for it yourself. I sat on a bench with a parcel of warm food on my knee and a bag of our favorite beer beside me. It was already evening, though at that time of year, twilight draws in much later, so I saw Maddie's gangly, jogging figure from a long way off.
Hey, it's cool you came.
He was panting, but it didn't stop him rejoicing at seeing me, and at a little physical exertion. We embraced, and he plopped himself down beside me.
Oh, living it up, 2 days running. Decent food.
Maddie took his wrapper and got stuck into his kebab. His stomach would organize a revolution out of sheer joy.
What do they feed you? If I'd thought, I would have grabbed something more substantial, I said, opening 2 cans of beer.
I'd already forgotten how easy it was to talk to Maddie about simple earthly matters. At work, everyone used office speak, even if they were talking about some new dish on the set lunch menu.
Powdered gruel, like what they give babies. Very little pleasure involved. It's just to clear the pipes out so they don't get gunked up.
So go on then, tell me. We haven't got much time.
Maddie somehow managed chat between mouthfuls. I took a swig of beer, then told him everything, just like at confession.
Yes, you're in trouble now, he said. Do you really want to work there? If you ask me, the people in Barliona will be more normal than there.
Maddie, they're offering me something Barliona doesn't have and never will. Reality. Sorry, but I want to live here. Yeah, I get it. You don't have to explain. In 6 months, you'll completely disappear. No, I like the idea of the clan. Let's try it. 6 months for setup and development, then we'll need a powerful advertising campaign. Then I'll hand over management to you and only log in for a couple of hours a day. Like that, huh? What the hell do we need advertising for? No offense, but even a genius director won't lead an all-vagrant clan to the top. We need advanced players with gear and money. It would be good to find a Mycenas or two. The Phoenixes and the Legends made names for themselves first. Then people came flocking to them. Now they always have plenty to choose from. A well-thought-out advert is half the battle. So, Maddie, we create a clan, we establish connections, we organize the collection and processing of materials, we do quests, we sign contracts with NPCs, and that's it. We're the victors in life. All we have to do is start and finish. You've already drawn up a plan? Asked Maddie in awe. Yeah, just now, I admitted honestly. They're installing me a pod, too. But I haven't got a clue. That's why I called. Come on, we've only got half an hour left. You're right, it's just a bit sudden. Maddie snapped out of his daydreaming about a happy future and looked balefully at his bracelet. If only I could take this bloody leash off. Anyway, listen. A new continent has just appeared. Reference information. Continents in Barliona. Astrum. A continent for players in North America. Kaltua. A continent for players in Africa. Kalragan. A continent for players in Europe. Celestial. A continent for players in Asia. Retrandia. A continent for players in South America and Australia. Stivala. A continent introduced in the latest version of Barliona with no geographical reference for players. For the remaining 30 minutes, Maddie gave me the gist without going into too much detail. He really did have an idea. While doing some blacksmith and engineer business, he'd wangled a rare quest connected with materials on Stivala. After the first settlement of the new lands, players began to mine resources and sell them at auction. Prices for demon ore were exorbitant, but it was still snapped up in seconds. Maddie pushed the boat out, too, and bought a little ore and some other ingredients, whereupon, for perhaps the first time in the game, fortune smiled on him. After you created an object, the system offered a unique handicraft task, only it demanded resources and funds. He couldn't boast either of these, but if he had a reliable clan, it might all work out. That was when he found out I'd lost my job, and he was struck by a ray of hope. I needed to create my character on another continent, get busy with some mining and lumberjacking, bust a gut while making others work too, demanding 10% to the clan, build a castle on the new continent to house the main stores, and wait for Maddie to show up. His last piece of advice concerned expenses imperative for a comfortable game, an account in the game bank, a mailbox, and a communication amulet with a game number. But I knew all that anyway. That was pretty much it. Our master plan to nail some unreal megabucks. I wanted to discuss the rest of the details over the phone, but Maddie rejected the idea categorically. Pods and phones are wired, and great ideas stolen without scruple. We parted on that good note, and without me saying out loud what I thought of the plan. At first glance, it looked utopian. At second glance, too. But what did I know about game economics? Nothing. Before you've done any digging around for yourself, it's silly to speak of the reality or unreality of any plan. Who was I to criticize without any alternative to offer? Returning home, I poured the first of that night's succession of coffees down my throat and fell to digging. For 3 hours, I scoured everything available, all the way down to advertising descriptions, guides, and official reference materials, until my head was in pieces. Most of what I read was almost worthless, and any essential information on the new continent was only to be found in fee-paying resources. Game specifics, extras, bonuses, advancement tips, videos, everything cost money, and sometimes quite a lot. Apparently this was due to an announcement by the Barliona administration that people would no longer be able to influence the mechanics of the game. Some recent large-scale bribery cases had forced the corporation to take extreme measures. Complete replacement of the development and support team by imitators. Programmers, scriptwriters, designers, cartographers, project developers, and testers were all laid off. Now, nobody could spill any beans. The market reacted instantly, and prices rocketed. Not so much on legacy content, but you could easily make reasonable money from selling new content. I decided not to use the seller's services, preferring to rely on my own experience. On the official site, the most valuable information about starting the game concerned a bonus for commercial accounts. If a player created a new character but left the choice of race, class, and initial location to the discretion of the game, they received a bonus. Since I had no thoughts on the matter, and I only wanted Maddie to see the right continent, I was delighted at the opportunity for random generation and the extra bonus for my lack of initiative. As long as the bonus was of use, of course. When I finished the theoretical preparation for immersion in Barliona, the clock showed I only had 3 hours plus journey time before work. It was too late to think of sleep, so I decided to check out the pod. Years ago, I dreamt about a huge grand piano in the middle of the living room. That dream, adjusted for time, had almost come true. In the middle, though not of the living room, and huge, though not a grand piano. In its dimensions, the professional pod for continuous immersion in the virtual reality of the Barliona game world was consistent with an unrealized dream. Maybe someday I'd enroll in a course and climb in there to play Vivaldi or Chopin. After pressing some buttons and carefully studying my new toy, I froze with indecision. To climb in or not to climb in? Hell, bring it on! This ultra-modern coffin was thought out to the last detail. I didn't actually have to climb in to like it, like in the vampire films, because the pod adopted an almost vertical position for loading and unloading the passenger. Inside, to my surprise, there were no horrible probes, tubes for bio-waste or other such-like fittings. Or rather, there were, but they only appeared and were aligned while the pod was returning to its horizontal position, so the player didn't experience fear or discomfort. I didn't even notice the roof closing. A platform came out. I went backwards onto it, and it went back in, depositing me into a chamber in the lower part of the pod, at which moment a hoop was lowered onto my head, taking over control of my brain. Absolutely no feeling of claustrophobia or being buried alive. Cool. I stopped sensing my body. All around was boundless and pristine space, and a message before my eyes. Welcome to Barliona. Description. We are delighted to welcome our new player. The initial settings of the pod are fixed. The sensory perception filters are set in accordance with your individual characteristics. Important. You are entering the pod after a long absence from the game. Be advised that the Barliona game mechanics have been significantly revised. You will find a description of the changes on the official game site. A redenomination has been conducted, equating the value of gold in the game with the value of credits in reality. The system confirmed I'd read the message to the end, and the message changed. Select a faction. Kartos, Malabar, Freelands, or Random. All the available sections were lit up in red. All I had to do was fix my eyes on an item, and it would instantly change color to green, changing back as soon as I looked at another item. All clear with navigation. There were actually many more factions in Barliona, but for our geographical location, only these were available. Maddie played for Malabar, so I didn't worry too much about my own selection there. The user agreement said the pond was able to read the upper layer of my thoughts. I fixed my eyes on Malabar and mentally pronounced Malabar. Select a faction. Are you sure? The Selection Assistance option provides the player with reference information concerning each faction. Yes, I don't need any assistance. My selection is Malabar. Selection accepted. Malabar. Select the race you would like to play for. List of races available in Barliona and their descriptions, or random. Random generation. This phrase was the key to loading the scene I'd read about on the website. Random generation of character selected. Necessary action. Define parameters for random generation. Minimum 4. Parameters. Faction. Race. Class. Name. Appearance. Geographical reference. Initial location. I shifted my gaze from one parameter to the next, making my selections, until only geographical reference was still red. Players from different factions could easily communicate and collaborate with each other, the only question being language barriers. Still, let's go for it. Geographical reference selection. Necessary action. Select geographical reference for your character. After confirming random generation, you can only change your race or class after 30 calendar days. Parameters. Choose continent. Go back. Cancel random generation of character. I need the continent of demons, Stivala. I confirm random generation of all other parameters. Instead of a message or a progress bar, in front of me appeared a gray-bearded and long-robed elder holding a staff. Resting his hands on the staff, he bowed his head in a dignified manner and said, "Greetings to you, free one. You have taken a decisive step." The old man pursed his lips deferentially and stroked his beard. "Such valor is worthy of reward. Barliona needs brave heroes, and it is encouraging that you are one such. Welcome to Barliona, Hero Kavalin." He knocked on the ground with his staff, then crumbled into a cloud of pixels, leaving the parameters of my character in his wake. Initial settings generated. Faction, Freelands. Race, Tiefling. Class, Demon Hunter. Name, Kavalin. Name from reserved list. Appearance, customized appearance of player. Geographical reference, Lokdar, continent of Stivala. Initial location, Demon Hunter Training Camp. What's a tiefling? Never heard of Demon Hunter. I can run around as a hunter? Kavalin is, well, Kavalin, who cares? All the rest we'll deal with later. Start game. The white space darkened, and a ball of mist appeared ahead. It grew, curled, and stretched, forming a silhouette. The figure gained substance and was complemented with features. And when the mist dissipated, I saw a horned, tailed, and hooved creature looking back at me. WTF! My first thought was, that can't be my guy. It's a goat. All that's missing is the beard. In response to my indignation, a somewhat sparse beard suddenly sprouted. Shit! And where's my bonus? The creature eyed me aggrievedly. Its pitch-black eyes had no whites. I looked it skeptically up and down and gave the mental order to give us a twirl. This is what they call customized appearance of player? The gray canvas coat didn't hide my spare tire, and the novitiate's pants refused to stay up on it. Way to go, tolerance. Although it's true, I was even fatter in real life. So tieflings are humans with tails, hooves, and goat's horns. If I bumped into my ex in Barliona, she would definitely say, I always knew it. She would also add that it was a hint at my subconscious and a manifestation of my real alter ego. Ugh, I was definitely going to change it in a month. I could just imagine Maddie's face. With that thought, I decided to learn how to change my parameters. The beard had materialized, after all. I began mentally saying what I wanted to change and assessed the results. The original image really was a work in progress, waiting to be tweaked. I altered the length and ramification of the horns, the appearance of the tail, the color of the skin and eyes, and various other things, until I got bored. Since the game was 18 and up, I ordered the tiefling to undress and appraisingly sized up its figure. I want a six-pack. The game responded humorously by drawing six beer bottles over the bulging belly. Ha ha. Okay, then. I want a sinewy, muscular body with 15% body fat. Oh, excellent. My gaze shifted down. Well, it was my customized body, and nobody had actually complained. I decided to leave it as it was. Making peace with my character's image, I found the save button with my eyes and read it mentally. Another message appeared. Birth of a tiefling scene launched. Description: A race-specific birth of a tiefling scene launches every hour. Next launch in 32 minutes. You will be put to sleep while you wait. We wish you a pleasant game. The tiefling assumed a sprinter's crouch before charging in a flash toward me, horns down. I felt odd and tried to step out of its way, but couldn't. I didn't have a body. At the last moment, when I realized collision was inevitable, I screwed up my eyes and felt nothing. No impact, no pain. But I couldn't open my eyes. The feeling of space suddenly changed. There was no time to even pin down or keep track of the moment. I was just suddenly aware of myself drowsing in a comforting liquid and experiencing fantastical blissfulness. I floated with closed eyes, occasionally bumping into something soft and warm, rejoicing in my own being and that of the warm, soft thing, and in our bumping. I loved this thing, and I loved our gentle physical contact, and it responded in kind. For in the ocean of bliss, there was room for all. There was no need to waste your breath on spite and aggression. Everything around was invoked to give us happiness. Arise, my children. Your hour has come. It is time to emerge into the light. A delicate and seductive voice sang out. Only a mother could speak so tenderly. Mother. I wanted to approach her and was afraid to upset her with my inertia. I must hurry. I reached out toward the voice, straining to open my eyes. It wasn't easy, but I tried. Mother would be angry if I was blind or came last. She didn't like failures and ate them straight after their birth. There was no place for weaklings among demons. I broke out in a cold sweat from head to toe. What freaking demon? When I understood the absurdity of my own thoughts, I opened my eyes. Then I screamed from shock. A normal reaction for a person who finds themselves swimming in a lake of molten lava. The world around was so natural, its colors so deep and voluminous, that my vocal cords seized up with fear and my cries were cut short. I managed to save my conscience by concentrating on the game interface buttons, which did not disappear even when I blinked. My brain accepted this as a weighty argument in favor of virtuality and was calmed. It's just Barliona. I'm in virtuality, surrounded by a pod. Nothing more. Everything's fine. I breathed out heavily and looked around. There really
was. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.